Hi, Shamai. In Bitcoin, we place a lot of emphasis on people having their own autonomy and building their own full nodes. But we don't place much emphasis on people building their own hardware wallets. And why not? Like, it's a good way to learn more about how Bitcoin works, how you sign transactions and how you generate seed phrases and derive addresses. So I'm really interested in people developing their own hardware wallets. So this project, the Bowser wallet, it's taking an M5 stack, which I know a lot of you already have from the point of sale tutorials and so on. It takes an M5 stack and it has a little Tetris game on it. And then behind there, there's a secret wallet, which we can access called the Bowser wallet. And it's a hardware wallet. So it's got a private key stored on here. We can have a watch only wallet on our laptop. And then using an SD card, plug an SD card in, and then using the private key stored on here, sign the transaction, take the SD card out, and then broadcast the transaction on our laptop. So this is the project. Let's take a little look at it. As always, all the information about the project is in the GitHub ARC BTC Bowser Bitcoin hardware wallet. Huge shout out to Stepan Snigravs, uBitcoin Arduino library. That library which he's created makes making a hardware wallet in for Arduino hardware very, very easy. So yeah, well, a massive shout out. None of this would have been possible without Stepan's incredible library. Some commands. So obviously we're communicating our transactions to the device via an SD card, but we can also, you know, restore from a seed or do a hard reset to the device, so get it to generate a new wallet for us. Some links for installing the Arduino IDE and then installing the ESP32 boards. The M5 stack is based on the ESP32, and you'll need to install the boards into the Arduino IDE in order for it to recognize the M5 stack. A couple of the libraries, the extra libraries you need to install, there's only two. There's the M5 stack library, which you can do from the library manager in the Arduino IDE, and then uBitcoin. So you'll have to download the GitHub step, the uBitcoin GitHub, and then in the Arduino IDE, I think it's like tools and import zip library. And then you should be able to install the library in the Arduino IDE. For those of you who are new to the channel, I don't want you to fall behind not knowing what a microcontroller is and a ESP32 and an M5 stack, blah, blah, blah. The M5 stack is a very nice form factor. It's a microcontroller. It's an ESP32 with a screen and some buttons all kind of built in into a nice little packaged product, which we can is modular and we can build things out of. So one of my projects is building a point of sale terminal out of an M5 stack with an additional keypad module attached to it. But under the hood, it is an ESP32, which almost all of my projects are based on. Very versatile microcontroller, which you can plug any component into, any SPI or I2C interfaced components, so cameras, screens, you know, there's an e-paper screen there, keypads, sensors, whatever. So very versatile and cheap as well. And so I tried to make it so if you buy one of these microcontrollers or you buy an M5 stack, then you should be able to make most of the other projects I do using the same microcontroller, so you don't have to keep buying hardware. And they're so cheap, why not buy them and have a little play and have a little go with them. The M5 stack, as a using this as a hardware wallet, I would feel confident putting, you know, an okay amount of funds on one of these hardware wallets. So if it were a local cafe, for example, and they wanted to accept Bitcoin on Lightning, and then you looped out to one of these, to a public key, which and their private key is stored on one of these little hardware devices. And if it's not a huge amount of money which is going on, then maybe just, you know, a few £1,000, then I would trust this device to be able to secure that relatively well. Anything more than that, I suppose it depends on your risk profile. Then, you know, go for a Trezor or a Ledger or some other, you know, a hardware wallet with a high security module kind of built into it. But then in saying that, if you look at a sort of higher security profile, so maybe an exchange which is using things like Trezors, to have a hardware solution in a multi-sig which isn't subjective to the supply chain attack is actually quite good. So you could even build a hardware wallet, one of these non-supply chain attack type hardware wallets, using some of these hobbyist electronics, and it would actually increase your security profile, even if you already had like quite a high security profile. Let's have a little look at the device and some of the basic functionality, and then we'll look at some of the more complex functionality. So when we turn on our device, we get the Bowser Tetris Chaos game. So this is just like any other Tetris game you've ever played. The idea being that, you know, if you get stopped by immigration force trying to come in and they ask what this little hardware device is, you can just say, oh, it's a, you know, it's just a Tetris game for me to play while I'm bored on the plane. Obviously, you know, in order to access the hardware wallet behind the Tetris game, what we need to do is we reset the device and then we press button C. So this is button A, B, and C here. So I'm going to reset the device and then I'm going to press button C quickly. So you have about a second to press that button before it just goes into the game. And then I have to enter my PIN, and it uses Morse code. And the PIN which I'm using now is SATS. So this button A is dot and then button B is dash. Okay. And the first thing it does is gives you a public key, so you can send funds to that public key. That's a fresh public key. I can press C for menu, go back to the, and the first menu item is display publicly. Every time I click on that, you'll see that I get a fresh public key. That means that if someone sends you funds, if you give this public key to somebody to send you funds, because it's derived from your master public key, they won't be able to see the rest of your funds. I can sign a transaction. I can export my master public key. So if we sign, so if we click on sign transaction, transaction found, signs a transaction. There's my unsigned transaction. Press A to sign. Save to SD. So now the transaction saved to SD card. We can also export my master public key. So this is the public key, the master public key, which you will use in Electrum to generate a watch-only wallet. And we can also wipe the device or restore from seed. Now I want to do a hard reset. So I'm going to take out the SD card, pop it into my computer, open up the file, Bowser.txt, and then in here, write hard reset, save, pop it out, pop it back into my Bowser wallet, restart, press the C button, and now, because I'm doing a hard reset, it's going to generate a new seed phrase for me. So, you know, go through, write those words down, and then take your seed phrase, put it somewhere safe. I always think splitting up your seed phrase is a good idea, and then having some sort of algorithm to jumble them up as well before you split them is something you'll be able to remember, is also a good idea. It gives you another opportunity to check that seed phrase. Okay, and then it saves those seeds, the seed to the SD card. If you're unsure about that as a secure for security reasons, there will be an opportunity in a bit for us to delete that bit of code. It asks you to enter a PIN, and it's using Morse code. So what shall our new PIN be? Shall we have SOS? So this is dot and this is dash, dot, dot, dot. Wait a moment. There's the S, dash, dash, dash. Wait a moment. There's the O, dot, dot, dot. SOS. Obviously, I recommend having like at least a five-letter password. So click on the C button to accept. And there we are. There's our public key. So we can go back. We can't sign a transaction because there is no, if I click on that now, no transaction found on SD cards. There's nothing on the SD card to sign. But we can go to export ZPub. So we're going to do that. It saved it to the SD card. So I can take that SD card out, pop it back into the computer. Now, if I reload that file, you can see here I've got my my master public key. Now I'm going to copy that master public key. In the the project on GitHub, you'll see that there's a file called Electrum Wallet Template. So this is kind of like a, it's the cold card template. So we're going to pretend to, Electrum's going to think that our device is a cold card device. So I'm going to paste in my master public key there, and then I'm going to save it as something on my computer. What shall I save it as? Bowser Wallet. Okay, save that. Then I'm going to open up Electrum. I'm going to click on New Restore. If you've not used Electrum before, it's very easy to install and run. Electrum's been, you know, a long-standing, very well-respected desktop wallet. It's available for multiple operating systems. So if you haven't installed it before, then you should install it. It's great. So this is just a regular, normal wallet here. So this has the private key and the public key on my computer, but it's only for small amounts. That's okay. But I want to import the JSON file, which I've just made. So choose, and then I'm going to go down to my browser wallet, open, click next. There we are. It's going to ask if I want to plug in my cold card. No, because obviously I haven't got one. And this is my watch only wallet right here. So I can, generate addresses. So I can generate an address. And then in my other wallet here, I can send some funds to it. Payment sent. And we should see pretty soon. There we are. Boom. So we sent funds from this wallet here, and it's sending it to my watch-only wallet. So we're able to send funds to this wallet. Something we're not able to do, though, is send funds out of this wallet because we haven't got the private key on my computer. The private key is saved on my hardware device, which is kind of the point. So what I'll do is I'll just send the money back. We won't be able to send any funds, I don't think, because obviously we've only got an unconfirmed transaction. But I can preview the transaction. So I could actually preview and sign the transaction now while waiting for the other the funds to actually confirm. So I'm going to copy that transaction. And then I'm going to go to, where are we? Bowser.txt. This is my little SD card. Delete that. Sign. And then paste in the transaction. Okay, then save. Right, so I'm gonna pop out that SD card. So in my hardware wallet, pop in the SD card. I will have to reset. Oh, wasn't fast enough. There we go. What's my passcode? Oh, it's SOS. 23 S O S. Okay, good, we're in. Sign transaction. Wahaha, transaction found. And it will show us the transaction so we can compare it with the one on our computer. Make sure it's the same transaction. Press A to sign. Gonna sign it. And now it's saved to the SD card. So now I can pop out my SD card, pop it back into my computer with our signed transaction using my private key. I want to reload that file. There we are, boom. And there is the signed transaction. Now I can copy that transaction, and then I can go to any old broadcasting service. Let's use this one, shall we? Block Cipher, paste that in there, broadcast the transaction. And now the transaction successfully broadcast. So we've got a couple of transactions in our mempool. We have an unconfirmed transaction, two unconfirmed transactions, one for 100,000 coming in to the 100,000 sats coming into our watch only wallet, and then 50,000 sats going out of our watch only wallet to our other wallet. And that's it. I was able to sign using my private key, which is stored on the hardware device and not on my computer. I was able to generate a unsigned transaction on my computer, take it out of the computer via SD, plug it into my hardware wallet, sign the transaction with my private key, and then pop it back into the computer. let's have a little look at the code for the project, shall we? So if we go back here, see what files are in here. Okay, so we have, what have we got? Oh, we've got this file here has the Morse code cheat sheet, and it's also got somewhere to write your seed phrase. This is the template for making that cold card template wallet, which we imported into Electrum. If we click on Bowser here, this is the actual folder which you want to take and put into your Arduino sketchbook and open in Arduino. And it's got four files, Bowser.ino, that's our main file, the decoy, so that's the Tetris game, and then game image, this is the background image for the game, and then the wallet image, which is the splash image for the wallet. So if we open up the project in Arduino, we can see those three files there. There's the decoy game file. That's also got a string at the top and an array, and that's our BIP39 word list for us to be able to generate our seed phrases for our wallets. There's our game image, and there's our wallet image. Okay, so let's have a little look at what we've got in here, shall we? So, you'll want to install, first of all, if this is your first time installing the Arduino IDE, you'll need to follow those instructions to install the ESP32 boards. And then once you've done that, you need to install the M5 stack library. So go to include library, manage libraries, search for M5 stack, and then install from there. And the other library, which is the Bitcoin, the uBitcoin library, you'll need to install that by downloading the uBitcoin GitHub, and then you go to include library, there we are, include library, and then add zip library, then navigate to it on your computer. Let's have a little look through the project and see what we've got in here. So, you know, it's quite a big project, you know, compared to a lot of my other projects, but it's still very easy to kind of read through and verify the code, even if you're not like a proper developer. So what have we got? We're calling our different libraries we need. So this Electrum library is actually part of the uBitcoin library. The EEPROM, that's a library which is included in the SP32 boards when you install those. And then I'm calling my files here, my three files. The hash library for doing things like SHA-256, that's from the uBitcoin library as well. And then SPIFS, that's the file system library which we're using, the SP32 file system library, so we can actually save little text files on the SP32 to store our seed phrase and a hash of our passcode as well. There's a PSBT, so partially signed Bitcoin transaction library. I don't think that's actually necessary, but I won't delete it because it's not causing any harm sat there. We've got a couple of booleans. Yes, no's, which we're going to use in our code. We've got some strings, so we can store some strings of data. We have a library, so a character array of a library here. This is the library we use for our Morse code. So a dot is a one, and then a dash is a zero. So if you're, you know, typing the letter O, for example, then that's dash, dash, dash. And then we can use that library then to, you know, to store, not to make a hash of our passphrase, and then check the hash the next time we log in. So in any Arduino, I think any C project, in fact, you have a setup function, and then you have a loop function, and that's what we've got here. So we start with the setup function. In the setup function, we're initializing the M5 stack, and then its internal libraries. We're setting the brightness to bright, 200. That may be a little bit too bright, actually. I might turn that down to 100. And then we're setting the screen to black, and we're running the decoy setup function. So that function is in our decoy.h file. If we scroll down to the bottom, here's our decoy setup file. So this is the main file to run and play the Tetris game. And you can see here that there's a little loop just when the game first turns on, and it gives you a second. So 1,000 milliseconds to press button C, and then once, if that's released, then it returns out of this function, and then we're able to get into a hardware wallet. And if you don't do that, it just sort of loops around the function, and then, you know, we get to play Tetris. So the brightness is dimmed down, so it's only bright for Tetris. Yeah, I might in fact just change that to 100. I don't think that needs to be 200. So here's our splash screen for our wallet. the Bowser wallet, and that stays up there for 3 seconds. We check to make sure we can access the SPISA, the internal file system. And if we can, we read key.txt, and that's where our seed phrase is stored. We also run this SD checker function. So as well as our setup and our main loop, I've made a whole bunch of other functions which we're able to call upon. So if I look for SD checker, if I can find it, some down here somewhere. Here we are. Here's SD checker. So it's a really small function. And then that just runs the read file function. And we're looking at bowser.txt on the SD card. So if we scroll down to the bottom of our project, read file, ba-ba-ba-ba-bam. It tries to read it, and then it reads the whole file and then puts it into a string called SD command. So if we go back up to the top, yeah, here we are, look. So we do our SD checker, and then we check that string SD command to see whether someone's initiating a hard reset. And if they are initiating the hard reset, we run two functions. We run the seed maker function, that's the function which makes the seed, and we run the pin maker function. Yeah, let's have a look at the seed maker function because it's an important one. Seed maker. You could use the edit and then find. That'd be a bit easier, but okay. So here's our seed maker. So I don't know if you remember, but it asks us to write those seed words somewhere safe. And then what do? We loop around our library 24 times and use Arduino's random function to randomly select a word each time. The ESP32, just like all electronics, is very noisy. So there's all sorts of electrostatic interference. Just the electronics actually in the M5 stack cause all sorts of random interference. And then where your M5 stack is, like it's kind of close to my laptop at the moment, start be creating some interference. So we're able to use that some of the entropy to make a nice random number to randomly pick a word from our BIP39 word list library. And then once we've done that, we loop around 24 times and then show each word. And then after we've shown each word, it says time to check the words, and then we get to see all the words again. Then it stores the words to our SD card. If you don't want that functionality because you think it's a risk, you can, let's have a look. So if you just took all of that and just deleted it, then that functionality would no longer exist. It wouldn't save those that seed phrase to your SD card. Pin maker, which is the function which is next, in fact. So that's where it says enter a pin with using Morse code, three letters at least. And then there's our enter pin function, and this is entering the pin and then making a hash. Where's our hash? We make a hash of the SHA-256 hash of the pin. We store the SHA-256 hash in pass.txt in the SPIFs in the internal file system. So we're not actually storing the passcode. That means the next time someone logs in, they put in a passcode, it makes another hash of that passcode and compares it to the hash it has saved in pass.txt. Let's have a little look at the top here. What else have we got? So that's our setup pretty much. Yeah, so that's if we do a hard reset. If we don't, say if we do a restore, there's a function called restore from seed. So instead of doing that seed maker, it just basically pulls the seed which you tell it to use on the SD card. It also does the enter pin function. Otherwise, if you haven't got hard reset or restore on the SD card, it will just run the enter pin function. So that's where after the Bowser wallet splash screen, it will just say enter pin and you enter your pin. So then we go into our main loop. So what have we got in our main loop? We've got a menu loop. So these are our menu items: display pub key, sign transaction, export at zpub, show seed, wipe device, restore from seed. So there are different menu items, and then depending on which one you've selected, that one's blue, obviously. So if you press C, then it takes that menu item number, whatever you may be. So say if you're at menu item 1 and you press C, it then runs menu item 1, which is the pub key thing. So it goes to Ah, yeah. So it has, there's a tiny TXC in spiffs, and it's just got a number. So it's storing the number one to begin with, and that'll be the first derived address from your master. So you take your master public key, and then you derive a public key from that master public key. But you want to be able to derive a new public key every time you use that menu option. So it stores that number and then adds one onto it. So it means that you've always got a fresh public key every time you click on the every time you click on the option, the menu option. But then Electrum, when it looks through it, you know, it scans through, you know, the first 1,000 derived public keys or something, and that's how it's able to know how many funds are attached to your master public key. Clever stuff. Right, sign a transaction, that's menu item 2. That's a biggie. Export ZPub. I won't go into too much detail. In fact, I'll probably leave it at that, to be honest. You can scroll through and you can vet the code and kind of figure out how it's working. Or if you can't, then just get someone with, you know, intermediate programming skills, and they should be able to, or even novice programming skills, and they should be able to confirm that there's nothing dodgy going on here. And you can see actually in my setup here, I'm not, like, you know, turning on the Wi-Fi module in the SP32 or anything and sending your seed out or anything. So have a little look through, verify the code. Even if you're not 100% sure how it works, just take your time to look through it. I don't think there's really much more to explain on that. So in fact, I mean, I can flash the device now so you can see how we flash it. Oh, let me turn on my camera. Okay. Oops. There we are. So you just plug your M5 stack in, and then in your Arduino IDE, upload the project to your M5 stack. It will take a while to compile because this is a big project. It's worth remembering as well that those spiffs will not be affected by me, you know, updating the firmware, which is essentially what you're doing when you're uploading a sketch to one of these microcontrollers. But the spiffs won't be affected by that. So my old seed and my old passcode, they work fine on the device unless I send that hard reset command to the device. Which is pretty cool. It means that, you know, if there's like a code update or something, you don't have to like then restore your seed. You can just update the code, and the seed and everything will be fine on the device. But do make sure that you take a copy of your seed, and then also you remember your passcode. And that's it. Finished. So, you know, pretty simple. You shouldn't have too many problems installing the Arduino IDE if it's your first time, and installing the M5 stack and Stepan's library. They're good libraries. They shouldn't give you any issues. And then you just flash it onto the hardware device. There will be more versions of this project coming out, I'm sure, because there's a whole bunch of microcontrollers I'm quite interested in. There's a new RISC-V, which is an open source microcontroller, and that's like £6 or sort of $8. That's a really nice one, and I really want to make one of those into a hardware wallet, and it has an SD card thing built into it as well, so I'll be doing another tutorial on that. But before then, you know, good luck, and good luck making your hardware wallets.